Yeah? Right?
Yes.
Deal?
Boing.
Welcome to the Acquia Podcast, Drupal technology, community, and business.
Welcome to the Acquia Podcast, Drupal technology, community, and business.
There's a module for that?
There, of course there is.
So, Tim Deeson, you run what's now called the Deeson Agency, is that right?
Yeah, that's our social media name, but just Deeson.
Deeson.
Yeah.
So what's the history of Deeson?
So Deeson is a family business. It was started by my grandfather in the 50s and was a contract publishing company, and is now in 2001 I started the digital agency, and that's the main part of the business, but we actually still have a small publishing company too.
Right, and you and I talked several years ago now on the podcast about the origins of the business and coming from print to digital and all of those things. And it's really one of those stories about like, I can build a website, dad.
Yeah. I came back from backpacking and a family friend worked for Apple. He taught me kind of how to hack around with Macs and stuff, and came back from backpacking, needed some money. This was kind of in pre-CSS days, actually, and just started making websites, kept picking up clients,
all right,
and kind of went from there. So in about 2007, we started doing Drupal.
Pre-CSS?
Yeah, this was Adobe Go Live, kind of. CSS was just starting to kind of come out then.
Do you still write your HTML in all caps?
Yeah. And I'm not allowed to write HTML anymore.
And do you still use spacer GIFs?
Yeah. And I just make a massive table, and it's mostly made up of one pixel GIFs to make it look nice. That's the only way I know, unfortunately. CSS kind of passed me by.
So they let you do the managing now?
Yeah. I'm more of the spreadsheets and the blog posts than the... probably more where my talents lie in reality.
Can you talk about the difference between delivering code or delivering Drupal and delivering value higher up the value chain?
Yeah, so I guess, I mean, I always look at these things as kind of nested. You know, often clients don't necessarily have a strategy that they're working to. And I think looking, things like Drupal are tools that nested within a strategy can deliver value because they have certain attributes, but it's starting from either the top or the bottom to understand, you know, if we want to grow sales in Europe, for example, it's then looking at, is there a digital channel to that, and how, what's a cost effective long-term way of delivering those sales reliably, and where does that kind of keep stacking up?
So I want a website, or I have a website, is no longer transformational, right?
No, absolutely. And we work really hard with clients to make sure that they understand what's the business change. Like, we always treat our projects as change management and kind of transformational projects, rather than no one actually wants a website. What they want is happier customers or better informed surgeons, or so we're always looking at what are the KPIs that will actually measure the business impact of the platform that we're going to build, rather than who should be biggest on the homepage, or is a carousel or a good thing or a bad thing. Whenever we get into those debates, we know that we've lost sight of, there's some key goals that for the business that are the things that really matter.
And the flip side of that coin, I think, is delivering websites, whether Drupal or whatever, is also not necessarily a differentiator anymore.
No, certainly not. I think, you know, digital agencies generally are kind of fighting the kind of commoditization of, if it's just, we think about agency work as kind of do for me, help me think, or think for me. So do for me is just build exactly what you're told, and it's very easy to make that kind of commoditized. Help me think starts to get into the UX and design side of the work. So I want you to help me work out what the features are of the site, and the kind of think for me is the strategy end. So they're coming to you with just a relatively short brief often of, you know, I need all of the surgeons in Europe who do heart surgery to kind of understand these training techniques. What are you going to do about it? And that's where we actually can work with them on that kind of overall strategy, which will have a strong digital element if they've come to us, but it's an open brief effectively.
Do for me, help me think, or think for me. Okay.
And we kind of, I look at that as the kind of commoditization curve really within the market, where if you're just delivering exactly what you've been asked to deliver, then that's very easy to nearshore or offshore, for example, and you're really competing on cost.
Yeah, or Squarespace or Wix or yeah. WordPress.com, right?
Yeah, and increasingly those tools are more and more sophisticated that the client can actually deliver those solutions themselves. There's not, you're not adding much value, you're not adding much intellectual value anymore, which means it's, you know, potentially not going to be good for rates and retention.
Right, so not only do you have to deliver more value, but you have to differentiate, right?
Yeah, exactly. And I think those things are kind of, I think they're often interlinked, but understanding what is the value that you're really adding, and some of them is kind of hygiene value, you know, reliable code, secure working platforms, but increasingly amongst the good agencies, and there's not endless amounts, but there are certainly competitor agencies, you know, there's a significant kind of chunk who I would count as, you know, they're great agencies. How do you then differentiate amongst yourself amongst those agencies as well?
Mm. So you and I have been talking a bit about one of the things that we might consider a differentiator, but I was wondering if you could talk about your recent journey in the world that we'll broadly define as diversity.
Yeah, so we, probably about 9 months ago, we were looking at DrupalCon Europe sponsorships, and it's kind of been an issue that had been in the back of my mind of, you know, are we representing the kind of communities that we're part of? And I had a kind of a niggle, really, that probably things weren't, it didn't feel right. Kind of intuitively, I thought we're probably not doing very well on this issue, and it's morally, kind of ethically, commercially, an issue that's really important that we do improve on. And we came into the DrupalCon kind of sponsorship season, and we were looking at some of the sponsorships, and Women in Drupal came up, and I was like, yeah, that sounds like something that would be really interesting and useful to support. I'm really happy to do that. And I thought, okay, what does this actually mean? Like, what's the point of Women in Drupal as an event? And kind of through that kind of process of analysis, I thought, started kind of just doing a bit of research, really, and started reflecting on how we performed as a company, and kind of came to a realization that while we had a kind of positive, well-intentioned kind of, we're not actively doing anything harmful. I kind of really kind of quickly realized, I guess, that we weren't also doing anything proactively, constructively, to kind of address what are issues in the industry, and certainly issues that I could see much closer to home within the company too. So we had a leadership team that the top four roles, none were women. Only one in the top 10 of our roles was a woman. So that kind of, it was instantly thinking, well, actually, that doesn't really sound like great gender balance if half the population are women. Statistically, we kind of seem to be, have quite a quirk in there.
Mm. Gender is, of course, not the only axis of diversity that you need to look at, right?
Yeah. So, I mean, we were kind of looking across the board, I guess, around race, sexuality. There was quite a few different characteristics that we realized it would be, you know, society as a at large kind of has historically not kind of performed well on, I guess, in terms of creating equal opportunities for people or
sure.
Discrimination.
Age is another one.
Yeah.
That I think's especially important. I've seen some organizations, you know, large corporate organizations, get to that tough point economically and then sort of fire everyone between senior management and middle management because they're the people in their 50s and they, you know, they're too expensive. And then 5 years down the track, 10 years down the track, make huge organizational mistakes because there wasn't a knowledge transfer and there weren't the people who'd gone through that mistake the time it had happened 15 years before.
Yep.
So there's, I mean, then there's so many ways. There's been a lot of studies about the economic and the business value of diversity. I have been part of teams, many different teams, I guess I should say. And I've felt myself that the more diverse a team you have, the better a solution that you can arrive to. So talk about getting more value out of your business this way. And I mean that in a positive way.
Yeah. I mean, I think doing the research, and there's some, you know, I wrote a blog post that listed a lot of the kind of research that I'd done because I found there wasn't necessarily an easy starting point to say, how do I become better informed on this issue kind of fairly quickly? And I think unconscious bias was something that I wasn't really that aware of as a topic, but quickly...
Well, it is called unconscious
bias. Yeah. So I guess I get some sort of pass on that. It's something that, unless you're aware of the fact that we all hold these biases unconsciously and they influence our behavior, our decisions, how we interpret the world, unless you're willing to kind of proactively engage with that and think that as an organization collectively, as well as an individual, this is something that's going to be, I'm actively trying not to discriminate, but unless you're a little bit more aware of what could be going on underneath, that some of the signals that you could be sending or some of the smaller decisions you could be making are going to be having an influence. That was something that I realized both had an impact on our work. So we do things like user experience research, design. These are very subjective processes where we're making very subjective decisions all the time. And without that awareness of how those decisions could be influenced, we were probably making poorer quality decisions. We were making decisions that would be, our defaults or our comfort decisions without having really potentially understood the problem space or the possibilities of what we could be doing. And that was something I felt that actually as a company, we really should be training for. Like some companies will have management and HR and hiring roles trained in unconscious bias, but actually it was something that I realized that, you know, we're creating solutions to be used in the wider world, often using significant parts of our judgment and evidence wherever we can, but judgment, even the decisions you make about where you're going to research, are going to have an impact. That was something that I realized I felt really strongly that actually we would benefit from as a company, that it would produce the quality of our work, but it would also create, I think, a much fairer workplace, a fairer culture, I guess, too.
Actually, while you were saying that, I thought to myself, thinking of this as a UX challenge might be a really useful paradigm. And there are several things about UX that come to mind completely spontaneously now. Some great UX practitioners that I've met are the people who can walk into work every day and look at the same interface and never get comfortable with it.
Yeah.
Never like get used to that workflow that you have to do that one extra thing that's really uncomfortable. They're never satisfied with that. And I think most people just learn how to click through whatever you do in a day and get on with it. And I think that... So fighting consciously against unconscious bias by remaining as open and as perceptive as possible, that sounds really great. And then I suppose if you designed it as a process, then I think you could then quite well, you could really proactively look for a great user experience of your organization, right?
Yeah.
I
think it's a good way to think of, you know, company culture and continuous improvement. And that process mindset is that you are kind of never done. And this isn't a problem that's going to go away. No matter what we do as a company, we can't solve it. No matter, the industry isn't going to kind of fix it overnight. Society isn't going to fix it overnight. And I think the problem with that is it can lead to kind of apathy or that's kind of stagnation in a way of like, yeah, this is terrible, but what are you going to do? And then everyone moves on to the next thing. And actually, I guess what I realized is that it's made up. There's a million small things that make this up, and actually you can nudge change by just doing what you can control. You know, it's not something that's just, you know, we're not going to fix it overnight, but that's even more of a reason to do something, because it's not that kind of problem. It's not, we can't all just make a decision and make it go away.
Nikki Stevens keynoted Drupal Camp Costa Rica 2016, and in her keynote, she talked about largely about diversity, but also about community and software. And she pointed out that any improvement that you can make, no matter how small, even if it's only for your local community, right, makes the world better, makes Drupal in our case better. It makes, you know, and so that's a great point that no matter how small a change you make today, it still adds up to make a difference. I like that.
Yeah, and it could have an impact, even if it positively impacts one person's life. There is these ripple knock-on effects. You know, it does prompt change and reflection in people that could, you know, influence the rest of their lives. And I think that's kind of, there's something really powerful that doesn't often always get, it kind of can get lost in the big company kind of, PR kind of spun version of how do you address this kind of thing. And I think it loses the fact that there's an evolutionary kind of iterative element to this, that it's about raising awareness. Like, it's not about people being... often not be about people being bad or wrong. It's about just how do you keep nudging this stuff in the right direction rather than just kind of doing one thing and then disappearing for another 5 years.
Compare being passively, happily open to everyone and accepting of everything, and if you come to us, you'll have a great experience. Compare that, which I imagine your state was a year or two ago, to proactively, we want to make Deeson a better company, and one of the measurements that we are going to take for our company's health and success is our diversity. So the passive versus the active.
Yeah, I think it's easy to be, to think of, I don't consciously discriminate, therefore we don't have a problem, and just kind of turn around and walk away. And that was really, really the state we were in.
Before. Tim doesn't have a problem. You have a problem.
Exactly. And I think it's realizing that the problem is much more kind of insipid than that in a way. It's kind of that unconscious bias, I guess, is baked into us as a society and us into humans, that we just carry these biases with us. And I think that kind of, the blissful ignorance that we were kind of in before, I guess, of, well, we're not actively doing anything kind of harmful, therefore we're fine. Once I started to gain more awareness, I guess, I realized that that just didn't really cut it, that by even our unconscious actions or our kind of how our careers page was written, for example, would be sending strong signals to candidates about who was welcome or not within the company.
Ah.
So if you have, you know, the stereotypical kind of startup.
We want rock stars and ninjas and senior, super, super senior developers.
Exactly. And the photos are of six guys playing pool late at night drinking beers, where you've probably, you know, started to send a message to people with families that if they want to see their families anymore, then they're not going to be welcome.
That's such a great point.
You know, it's that kind of, you just start to go, and actually, maybe if you're a woman and you don't want to spend the rest of your career surrounded only by men in their 20s, you've made an age point, you've already started to kind of say, to indicate who's welcome here, who fits in, who's kind of the default, and who are you? And I think you know, thinking about kind of how prominently you talk about parental leave, for example, because if you're not talking about parental leave at all during recruitment, then you're really probably aiming at much the younger end of the market. There's all these sorts of things. One thing I found was really interesting about, so we used to have a big push on open source contributions, like if you're being hired for a technical role, we really, really want to see that you've been active in the open source community. And what I realized, how that could be quite discriminatory potentially, is if you were, say, a single mum, you're not going to have had the, potentially you're not going to have had the time or the money to be doing loads of free work on open source code, because you're bringing up a family and working to support them.
Or you might be a great developer of any age or whatever, who had an employer who didn't include it or permit it at all, and you know, you have a family or you have a hobby or you have an actual life.
Yeah.
I wish I knew what that was like. No, I'm kidding. But yeah. Right, yeah, so that's a great point. That's like the idea of even how you like what photos you put on your website to talk about your own company. That's really, really.
And what language you use, does it feel like a competitive adversarial, like you've got to be Top Gun style, you know, there's this very or is it about we support people to do their very best? And there's some really interesting studies that show how that kind of language will be stereotypically responded to by men versus women, for example.
Sure. In the very early days of Acquia, and I mean, I've been at Acquia for 8 years now, so I think some of this has now, I think the statute of limitations has expired. We had rockstar, ninja hiring language on that page, and I know, because I had the conversations with people at DrupalCon and what have you, that... So the light just went out on the video. Everybody hold your places.
It might be a motion sensor.
An emotion sensor.
Yeah. There we go.
So what emotion do you have to feel to turn off the lights?
Yeah.
Hey, so lights are back on. I had conversations with people at DrupalCon that said... And like amazing people. People that would have been great... at that phase at Acquia, you know, oh well, I don't think I, you know, I couldn't call myself a rock star, so I didn't, I never, oh, do you think, I don't think I could ever apply to Acquia, you know, it's like,
yeah, you end up with a self-fulfilling prophecy as you hire more and more people like the people you have, because, you know, it's a marketing test in a way. Your recruitment marketing appeals to a certain type of person, which means it attracts a certain type of person, which means you create a culture which has a certain type of person. And that's often can be a narrow, a narrow slice, really, of the variety of people that would be, you know, have a really much, bring a lot of benefit to the company and some different perspectives that can stop a kind of very narrow group think, I think.
And to your point, because it's unconscious bias, often that sort of just happened to us and we don't know why, because we would be really open to having everybody, right?
But no one applies, which I mean, that was kind of one of the points I made in the blog post, was around the kind of pipeline problem of, you know, it's the pipeline. We don't get applicants. So what can we do? And actually one of those kind of issues is that, well, partly you don't get those applicants because you only appeal to one type of person. You've made it clear that it's only a safe, welcoming place for certain types of people, because every single piece of your marketing says that unintentionally and unconsciously. But, you know, that was the other kind of part I found of just by raising awareness. There's very rarely kind of a right or wrong kind of cultural decision to make about these things, is that just raising the awareness and prompting the debates internally started to change our culture in terms of growing awareness of how an impact of certain language or certain environment choices could have an impact on people. So one of the things was the use of kind of guys when we're talking to a group of people that may or may not include all men.
The word guys.
Yeah.
You have just hit on one of my biggest pet peeves. So, time out, everyone. Land at London Heathrow any day of the week, especially if you come off a big international flight and Terminal 5 is really full. You have all those helpful people standing around yelling at you, right? So, an aircraft, 300, 800 adults, well enough dressed, tired, jet-lagged. Honestly, the last thing I want to hear, like, how about, excuse me, ladies and gentlemen, please go down this way. I don't need to be sir, right?
Yeah.
But yes, excuse me, everyone move this way. All these things would be great for me. I'm sure there are other good options.
Yeah.
And instead, what is it? Guys, guys, down this way. Yeah, guys, please move along, guys.
Yeah.
And it does my head in that guys is now the formal way to address a group. Yeah. And thanks to Tim Deeson, I now know that this is maybe a symptom of this unconscious bias as well.
Yeah. And I think it's, you know, so sometimes that debate can get derailed into, do I find it offensive or not offensive? And I think in my experience, people generally don't. It's actually about sending this really subtle, tiny signal that actually the default of people we're talking to are men in these situations.
Yeah. Plus, I have to say that offense is actually not a yardstick to measure by, because it's very subjective and very emotional and it doesn't exactly matter. Stephen Fry talks a lot about the concept of, you know, your offense is not my business, right? Because that's a really interesting point as well.
And it derails, I think what's unfortunate about it is often it can kind of veer into this political correctness kind of issue.
And apologies, so we're not talking about anything that needs apologizing for. You were doing something to fix it now, right?
Yeah.
So I don't like long self-flagellating kind of conversations about this stuff either. So that's a fair point. Tell me, have you formulated a goal for Deeson in terms of diversity? Is there something, is there a simple statement that you've got?
So we, at the end of the blog post, I published 10 things we were going to start doing or stop doing, basically. So for example, only attending conferences that had a credible code of conduct, for example. So to ensure that there was consideration of what would create an inclusive, positive environment for all participants, rather than where conferences, I mean, some of the reading I did, it kind of, if you don't do the reading, it can sound kind of, is this really that big a deal? But particularly in the US, there's been incredibly serious, incredibly common kind of incidents at industry conferences where you think actually there's just no real consideration paid to kind of large chunks of the audience effectively. So we kind of worked out, I personally don't believe in kind of targeting percentages, for example, because I think it can create all sorts of problems. What I found was is actually it was about the environment we were creating rather than about kind of absolute numbers. So you can use percentages as a kind of dipstick of, does this feel representative of the communities we're in?
Right.
But actually it was about if we make sure that our recruitment marketing makes it clear that we're a welcoming, inclusive environment to everyone, not just to people of a very small group or a very narrow group. Those kind of knock-on effects, I guess. So it was the behaviours that we take and undertake rather than the kind of being particularly attached to specific outcomes, because I think the outcomes will come through the, what you don't want, I guess, is just to try and force through once we hit some certain percentages, then that's what good looks like, and actually you haven't changed any of your behaviours, because that's where you can end up in some really troublesome, you're not going to create
those those old conversations about a token woman or a token what have you. So rather than a concrete statement or a concrete goal, would it be fair to say that you have a process that you are executing on every day, and that your end goal is simply improvement on this area?
Yeah, I think that's the only way to think about it, is continuous improvement and awareness raising. It's just thinking, it's thinking about the kind of issues. Having that awareness of the issues just makes you prompt some conversations that don't otherwise happen, I think.
Okay. So I'll link to that blog post for sure, and I'll probably quote your 10 points in the post with this conversation. Hey, so Tim, thank you for taking the time to talk with me. I really admire your moment of revelation per se, but especially that you're acting on it. And I think it would be really cool if we check in again on this at a, at an apropos moment.
Of course, yeah. Thank you so much for having me.
Great. Thanks, Tim.
Cheers.